So welcome everybody to Sleep for Peak Performance. My name is Dr. Michael Breus. Hopefully many of you know me. And I'm a big fan of the Mind Valley community. So first of all, thank you all for having me. So let's talk sleep, right? So here's the thing to remember is there are two separate systems in the brain for sleep. One is called your sleep drive. The other is called your sleep rhythm. So sleep drive is a lot like being hungry, right? So I get hungrier and hungrier and hungrier throughout the day. And when I eat something, that hunger begins to drop, right? The same holds true with sleep. Throughout the day, when a cell eats a piece of glucose, something comes out the back end. One of those things is something called adenosine. Adenosine works its way through the system and goes to a very specific receptor site in your brain. As adenosine accumulates, you get sleepier and sleepier and sleepier. So more adenosine, more sleep, right? That's what makes you fall asleep. However, what keeps you asleep and what tells your body, this is my time for sleep, is called your circadian rhythm. So a circadian rhythm is also a little bit like hunger. You ever notice you get hungry around breakfast time, around lunchtime, and around dinner time? Well, the same holds true with sleep. Most people, at least here in North America, have a tendency to get sleepy somewhere between 10 and 11 o'clock at night. Now, in different parts of the world, and we've got lots of worldly people here, there are different times culturally when people like to sleep. So there's lots of different variation that's going on out there. The basics are, when your drive is high, when your rhythm is on point, you sleep. But if either one of them is off, you either end up with a sleep disorder, like apnea, narcolepsy, insomnia, restless legs, or what I call disordered sleep. What is disordered sleep, Dr. Breus? It's not an official diagnosis, but it's, I went to that room in the back of the house. I was there for 5 or 6 or 7 hours. I come out and I don't feel so great. What's going on here? That's the area that I've spent tremendous amount of time.
Michael, excuse me? Mm-hmm. Would you mind sharing the full screen while pressing on swap displays so that we can see the full big slides?
Swap displays like that?
Yeah. Yes, that's perfect. Thank you so much. I appreciate that.
So now what we want to do is we want to move on from the drive and the rhythm discussion to sleep stages and what all those mean. So this is a graphical representation of a sleep stage, right? And so what does that mean? So orange represents being awake. So you go from wake down into stages 1 and 2, which is in the light sleep bar. Then you go down into the deep sleep, which is the dark blue. Then you go back to the light sleep, which is the gray, and then on into REM sleep, which is represented by the light blue. So that little dance maneuver there is called a sleep cycle. Average sleep cycle, 90 minutes long. Hopefully you remember that, because it's going to be important in just a moment. Average number of sleep cycles, we count sleep cycles by REM periods. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 REM periods, that turns out to be the average amount of sleep cycles is 5. That's going to become important in just a second as well. So what are these sleep stages, Dr. Breus, and why do I need to know them? So stages 3 and 4, which represent about a quarter of the night, maybe 20-23%. This is the wake up and feel great sleep, right? This is your physical restoration. Your blood pressure begins to drop, your respiration slows. But here's the best part about it all. We've all talked about anti-aging, feeling younger, feeling better. Growth hormone is where that happens the most. Everybody's looking for growth hormone. Everybody's trying to take a supplement to increase growth hormone. Everybody's trying to keep the growth hormone that they have. Here's the secret. All you have to do is go to bed. Right? Growth hormone is emitted during stages 3-4 sleep, which is in the beginning part of the night. And this is kind of like how the body repairs itself. So if you ever took your car into the body shop and they buff out the scratches and the dinks and the dents and all those things, that's what stage 3-4 sleep does for your body, is it really helps all of that stuff come together. And growth hormone turns out to be important. Remember, it's in the first third of the night. REM sleep is a little bit different. Makes up about 25% of the night, and this is where your mental restoration has a tendency to occur. This is where we move information from our short-term memory to our long-term memory. So there's a very specific function there. Our muscles become relaxed. In fact, our muscles become so relaxed that they become paralyzed. Many of you may have experienced this before. Some people will wake up and their body will still be paralyzed. That's called sleep paralysis. Don't worry, that's a common thing. It really means that you're sleep deprived, don't have enough good quality sleep, and that's why that's occurring for many people. Believe it or not, during REM sleep, your blood pressure increases, not decreases. You lose more weight in REM sleep than in any other stage of sleep because your body uses glucose more than anything else. And we know that dreaming occurs because of this movement of information from your short-term memory to your long-term memory. The way your brain figures that out is by creating a story that it can follow, right? So it takes that information and it puts it into that filing cabinet in your brain. And the way it does that is through a story that your brain is telling you. So that's how you understand what's happening. And again, mostly in the back third of the evening. Now, that's it for the science, okay? We're gonna now use all of our information to be practical and to change the way we're sleeping, okay? So the first thing we're gonna do is we're gonna have a bedtime calculator. I mean, let's be honest, when was the last time somebody told you to go to bed? What were you, like 8, 10 years old, something like that? So the thing to remember here is we take our socially determined wake-up time and then we subtract 7.5 hours. Michael, where'd you get 7.5 from? Remember, each cycle is 90 minutes long. There's 5 cycles. So 5 times 90 is 450 minutes divided by 60 to give us hours is 7.5 hours. And that's how you figure out your optimal bedtime. So as an example, if you normally wake up at 6:30, which is about the time I have a tendency to wake up, if you subtract 7.5 hours, then you would go to bed at 11. So first of all, I want you to notice something. 8 hours is a myth. Very few people need exactly 8 hours. The math doesn't even work, right? I mean, if you look at the math and you say the average sleep cycle is 90 minutes, the average person has 5 of those, that's only 7.5 hours, right? So don't give yourself a hard time about not getting 8 hours. I don't get 8 hours. I'm the sleep doctor, guys, and I don't get 8 hours, okay? So people are like, oh, Michael, what time do you go to bed? So I followed this regimen pretty closely. And here's what I discovered. I would go to bed at 11 and I would wake up at 5:30. Let me be clear, I'm a wolf, I'm a night owl. The last thing that I'm interested in doing is waking up at 5:30. To be fair, the only thing I don't like more than mornings are morning people. You guys are too damn chipper in the mornings, it's just not for me. This is not the thing I want. I certainly don't wanna be awake at 5:30 in the morning. I went to bed at 11, woke up at 5:30. Then I said, okay, I'm gonna try something different. I went to bed at midnight, more like a wolf, and guess what? I woke up at 6:30. What's going on there? So number one, my sleep cycle wasn't 90 minutes. It was 83 minutes. Michael, how did you figure that out? Guys, I work in a sleep lab. It's not that hard, but I also have an Oura ring, right? You can track your sleep and you can figure out about the amount of your sleep cycle. So that's certainly one way. But here's what I discovered is I went to bed at my chronotypical bedtime, which was midnight. And I was able to fall asleep more easily and stay asleep significantly longer than I normally would have. So this becomes very, very interesting in a lot of different ways. So when you sleep is equally as important as for how long you sleep. And this is gonna be based on your chronotype, right? So your wake up time, if you're a lion, is gonna be very early, probably in the 5:30, 6 o'clock range. But if you're a bear, remember being a bear is the best because there's more bears than anybody else. And you guys have got a great schedule going. That's more like a between 6:30 and 7:30. If you're a wolf like me, you really shouldn't wake up before 7:30 or 8 o'clock. And dolphins, who are my kind of my problem children, right? You guys kind of go up and down with your sleep. You really do want to wake up somewhere between 6 and 6:30 because it kind of helps start your day. For you guys, exercising in the morning is going to be very helpful. Now, what happens if you didn't get a great night's sleep? What happens if you only slept for 4 hours and you are dragging it and you want to have some energy? This is one of my favorite things to do. It's called the nap a latte. So I coined the phrase, what you do is you take a 6-ounce cup of drip black coffee, no dairy, no sugar. Add 3 ice cubes merely to cool it down. Drink it as fast as you can, then immediately take a 25-minute nap. You don't want to take a nap that's longer. Most people realize if you nap longer than 25 minutes, you actually feel worse, not better. So I always tell people only 25 minutes. And what happens is your brain burns through the adenosine that was making you feel sleepy. The caffeine fits into that molecular structure very easily. You're good for 4 hours guaranteed. 4 hours guaranteed. This thing works. So if you're really dragging and you need something to save you, try a Napa latte. Please do not do a Napa latte every day. That's not good. but if you need it, you can definitely use it. So what does good sleep do? It literally does everything. Look at all of these functions in the body. You know, you often hear me saying, everything you do better with a good night's sleep. I'm gonna say that that's correct. I mean, I really believe that to be true. every organ system and every disease state is affected by sleep. And when you don't get good quality or quantity sleep, it's negative. And when you do get good quality and good quantity sleep, it's positive. So there's a tremendous number of things that good sleep can do for you. So what I thought I would do here is I would stop for a moment and we can answer a few questions. Greta's gonna help me with that. Hi, Greta.
Hi. Yes, I'll definitely help. So one thing that I think a lot of people are asking is they notice that when they're emotionally drained or very tired, right, and they feel burnout, they're sleeping way more. Yes. And then usually they just need to sleep no matter what kind of chronotype they are. Right. So what would be your tips besides, let's say, you know, a bath or something for people to manage this?
So first of all, let's take a step back for a second and let's talk about why is everybody so stressed out right now, right? And why are they more emotional right now? Okay, let's be honest. Nothing has been as stressful as this in our entire lives. I mean, across the world, we're talking about a pandemic, guys. I mean, I'm 52 years old. I don't remember anything like this ever happening in my lifetime. So the level of stress is significantly higher. And it's a different kind of stress, to be clear, right? I'm worried about my health, but I'm also worried about the health of my children, of my extended family, of my friends. I've never worried about the health of my friends before, but now you bet your butt I am. Right? I'm worried about finances. I'm worried about career. And to be clear, I'm not like a big worrier, but we're all worried about these things because it's a unique, unique situation. Here are the things you must do. And I'm going to talk about this a little bit later in my lecture because I've got some COVID specific recommendations, but a couple of things that I want you to remember. Wake up at the same time every single day. I don't care if it's the weekends or the week. Even if you want to sleep more, don't. Here's why. What's happening for a lot of people is depression, right? And so when we talk about a massive amount of emotional stuff and a lot of stress going on, the need to sleep more actually is probably more the need of depression or escapism, right? So a lot of people are saying, I don't want to deal. I'm just going to go to bed, right? Honestly, that's really not the best use of your time. It's really much better to wake up at that consistent wake-up time, whatever it is for your chronotype, and then going to bed at your chronotypical bedtime. The consistency of that schedule will tighten it up and improve the quality. So when you're sleeping at various times, your body doesn't know when to give you the quality sleep because you keep sleeping. So, but if you have a compact situation, right, you know the hours, you know what time to go to bed and what time to wake up, your sleep will be better as long as it's consistent. It takes 21 days to get there. So if you do my quest, it's the perfect timing to do something like that and help you out. All right, Greta, what's my next question?
Thank you for sharing. I actually have a follow-up question. So let's imagine that I wake up every day at the same time and go to sleep at the same time. But some days, work is more stressful or family is more stressful than other days. Are there any key tips or something that I can maybe get ready for sleep or get even better sleep so that during the day, I'm not so overwhelmed and over the place?
Yes, there is. And that's the perfect segue into the next slide in my presentation. You're so good at this, Greta. I love it. Fantastic. So why don't I share my screen and I'm going to give people five tips of things they can do during the day to help them sleep better at night. Let's do that.
That's perfect. Let's do it.
Okay. So there we go. Back to here. Five things that we can do during the day that can help our sleep at night. So what's the first thing? I know you're not going to be happy with me on this one. Let's talk about caffeine. So it turns out that sleep in and of itself is a dehydrative event.
We're not yet seeing your screen. I'm sorry. We're not seeing screen yet.
Oh, that's weird.
Right, no, it's not shared yet.
Okay, we're working on it.
Just on Zoom link, maybe share the screen.
Share screen.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, no, this one. No, this one.
Not yet. We're getting closer. I feel it.
I promise everybody. I apologize.
It's okay.
My computer's acting crazy. Is there...
At the bottom of the screen of your Zoom call, there should be a share screen green button.
Yeah, I'm trying, but my computer is not letting me.
It's okay.
Something's weird with Zoom on my screen. It's not because I'm All right, hold on, guys. I promise we're going to figure this out.
It's totally fine. And everyone, maybe while we are waiting for this, you can share, if you did chronotype quiz, what is your type, so that we see if actually we have so many beers or not. And we have the screen. Perfect.
There we go. Am I back? Can you see me?
Yes. Yes. That's perfect.
Phew. All right, guys. Technical problems averted. Thank you, Team Mind Valley, for helping me out. Okay. So we're going to go back a little bit to coffee. So remember, caffeine, you want to have it 90 minutes after you wake up. Because your body is dehydrated, if you add caffeine, it makes it worse. It makes you actually, it's a diuretic, so it makes you have to go to the bathroom. So we don't want to drink coffee as our first thing in the morning, but if we want it to give us a lot of lift, there are certain times that coffee is better. And that turns out, based on your chronotype, 90 minutes after you wake up. So if you took the quiz, you should have gotten an email from me that tells you all about your chronotype and even tells you the perfect time to have coffee, to exercise, to go to bed, things like that. So remember, 90 minutes after your wake-up time, that's when you really want to have your caffeine. You got to stay hydrated. I mean, I can't say it enough. I keep like one of these little water, you can't really see it, one of these big water bottles by my bed because it's reusable. And I will have water when I wake up in the morning, usually somewhere between 16 and 20 ounces of water to help hydrate me. But hydration is the key. Do yourself a favor. When you wake up in the morning, grab your water, right? And then walk over to the window or go outside and get direct sunlight. What's the science behind this? Sunlight turns off the melatonin faucet in your brain. So it's a great way to help wake you up in the morning. Do me a favor, put on a robe. I'm just saying, if you woke up and you don't sleep in any clothing and you walk outside, your neighbors might be surprised. That was my best joke. I'm just telling you, it was my best joke. Okay, guys, physical activity. So the best way to improve your sleep quality is with physical activity during the day. It just is. So remember, most of us are not moving. Sleep is recovery. That's what sleep is. And so when we're not moving a lot during the day, our sleep becomes lighter and less quality at night. So everything that you can do to move around during the day is going to be helpful for your sleep. And then stopping caffeine turns out to be important as well. Now, caffeine has a half-life of between 6 and 8 hours. So it could take quite a while for it to get out of your system. So if you stop at 2, 8 hours later is 10, which is roughly the bedtime of many people. Now, to be fair, if you're in Latin America and you took a siesta during the day, then maybe you can stop caffeine a little bit later because, in fact, you're going to bed a little bit later. There's a little bit of variation there, of course, depending upon your culture. Those are 5 things that you can do during the day. Let's talk about what can you do at night in order to get for better sleep. We got to talk about alcohol. It's the one big one, right? So alcohol is the one sleep aid that is used more than any other in the world, and it's the worst. Alcohol is not what we really want to be having out there. So you want to limit your alcohol intake. It takes the human body 1 hour to digest one alcoholic beverage. So if you have 1 glass of wine, have 1 glass of water and wait 1 hour before bed. 2 glasses of wine, 2 hours, and 2 glasses of water before bed. Once you hit the 3rd glass, problems happen. So from a sleep perspective, when you get more than 2 alcoholic beverages in your system, it really destroys your sleep. Also, to be fair, it lowers immune function dramatically. Right now, we all want our immune function, so we really need to make sure that we're not using a lot of alcohol these days. I love exercise. Remember, it improves sleep quality. Don't do it too close to bedtime, because one of the things we know is that body heat makes it difficult to fall asleep. So if you're running and doing lifting and doing all these great things right before bed, it will actually make it difficult for you to fall asleep because of your body temperature. So what do I do before bed is I take an hour and I chop it up into 3 20-minute segments. So remember, going to sleep is kind of like landing a plane. You need some runway, right, to get there. So that hour represents that runway. So during that hour, and I've got some specific recommendations in a moment, take 20 minutes to just do the stuff you got to do. So in our house, it's getting our kids' backpacks together, shoes, sports equipment, that kind of thing. 20 minutes for hygiene. So brush your teeth, wash your face, maybe take a hot bath. And then 20 minutes for some form of meditation, relaxation, prayer. There's a lot of different things you can do to slow yourself down. One of my favorite is a gratitude list. I keep a notepad by the side of my bed, and I just write down right before I go to sleep a few things that I'm really grateful for. To be clear, there is data to support this idea. This is not just a kind of fun thing to try to do. There's data that now shows that when you're optimistic, that is positive, before bed, not only do you fall asleep more quickly, but you improve your dreams. Who doesn't want good dreams? So writing a gratitude list, number one, it makes you feel very good, but number two, actually helps your sleep. Definitely something you want to try. If you take one thing from this lecture today, wake up at the same time every day, no matter what. I don't care if it's Saturday, I don't care if it's Sunday. Pick your wake up time, hopefully based on your chronotype, and stick to it. I promise you, it will help. I'm the only sleep doctor in the world that says that television is okay before bed. I know you heard it here. Now, I want to be clear about something. Only a certain type of television is okay before bed. No media. You do not need to know how many people died of COVID in your town right before you go to sleep, right? I mean, that's crazy. If you want to watch a romantic comedy, if you want to watch an old episode of, you know, Seinfeld, or a movie that you and your partner have been looking forward to, maybe not an action movie, maybe something that's a little relaxing and calming, just something, again, to slowly get you there before bed. I'm okay with television, but I don't like is telephones. Can you see my phone here? Telephones, not a good idea. Two reasons. Number one, it's closer to you, so the blue light that's coming from it can have an effect. Again, if you don't want to have blue light going in you, then you need blue light blocking glasses. I think I look a lot like Bono, don't you think, right? Or maybe Elvis Costello, if you guys know who that is. So blue light blocking glasses, these are amber lenses. They must be amber. And they block the spectrum of light that is considered blue. That's 460 to 480 nanometers. That light, when it hits a particular cell in your eye, turns off your melatonin faucet. You want melatonin at night. So 90 minutes before bed, I stick these on and they help dramatically. Keep it cool is the other big thing. So you can see 18 degrees Celsius, that's about 65 or so, I think, 68 in Fahrenheit. You want to keep it as cool as possible. Cooler is better when it comes to going to bed. Now, one thing is I now actually offer a service. I'm a high performance sleep coach, and I actually can do your sleep genetics. So I can take your 23andMe data or your ancestry.com data, and if you send it to me over the internet, I can actually run a study on it, and I can tell you, based on 74 different sleep markers, exactly what your sleep looks like and what you need to watch out for in the future. So the science is getting better and better. Now I want to give you my favorite recipe for magnesium. So when I'm working with all of my clients, the very first thing I do is I look at their vitamin D, I look at their magnesium, I look at their iron, and I look at their melatonin, those four things. When people are low on magnesium, this is one of my favorite ways to get people natural magnesium. It's called banana tea. To be clear, there's no tea, it's just a banana. So it turns out bananas are loaded with magnesium, but the peel has got three times the amount of magnesium as the fruit itself. So here's what you do is get an organic banana and just wash it off. Cut off the tip, cut off the stem, cut it in half, leave the peel on and the fruit in it. Take these two halves of banana and drop it into 3 cups of boiling water and boil it till it turns brown. Then drink the water. As my daughter says, Daddy, it's very banana-y. So you really have to like bananas, but it's loaded with magnesium. I had one mom and she would make a pitcher every like Mondays, and then she poured it into popsicle molds and she gave it to her kids at night and it was great. Here's the best part about this magnesium is it doesn't interact with anything. It's safe for children. It's safe for seniors. Like, it's the best way to do it. So have a little banana tea or boiled banana water before bed. It will absolutely positively help you with your sleep. So what I figured I would do is I would synthesize it all, and I'm give you a five-step program to teach everybody how to get a great night's sleep, okay? So step number one, pick one wake-up time and stick to it. Step number two is to stop caffeine by 2 p.m. Step number three is to stop alcohol 3 hours before bed. Step number four is to exercise daily, but to limit exercise 4 hours before bed. And step number five is to get 15 minutes of sunlight every morning to turn off that melatonin faucet in your brain. Now, don't worry, we're gonna take this slide and we're gonna push it out to everybody so that you know what the steps are. Or if you wanna take a picture, feel free. I don't have a problem with that. I believe we are recording this, so don't worry, this will be available in the future. What I've done next is I've added five more steps based on COVID. So let's talk about other things that we can be doing that can be helpful during these times. So step number six is put yourself on that media diet. You just don't need to know what's going on politically. You don't need to know what's going on COVID-wise. What you need to do is chill out before bed. So do yourself a favor. Step six is put yourself on a media diet 90 minutes before bed. Step number seven is one of my favorite relaxation techniques, and it's called progressive muscle relaxation. This is a wonderful, wonderful technique that you can do, and it's where you tense and relax your muscles. Now, as a thank you for everybody that came here, we're going to put, we have a website where people can go and they can actually download a free audio version of a progressive muscle relaxation with my voice. So you can check it out. Or if you've done the sleep quest, you probably heard me that way. But progressive muscle relaxation is fantastic and I use it all the time and it really works. I can't say it enough, but that gratitude list is a big one for me. I know it sounds a little goofy at times, but the truth of the matter is there's real data behind it. And I don't know about you guys, but it just feels good to do it. So I recommend it for sure. Hot bath or shower 90 minutes before bed. So when you turn off the TV, turn on the tub, right? Remember, Mr. Bubble is your friend. Bubble bath makes it work a little bit better. And then my final recommendation is guava leaf tea. So this is an interesting one. So you heard me talk about banana tea and you heard me talk about a Napa latte. What is guava leaf tea? This is actually a real tea. I got some right here. See if you can see it. It's guava leaf, not guava fruit and not guava juice, but guava leaf tea. This leaf, and it tastes a little medicinal, it helps keep your blood sugar stable all night long. One of the big reasons that people seem to wake up at like 2:30 in the morning has to do with blood sugar. So this tea I've found has been very, very helpful for many of my patients to actually do quite well. So with that, I want to remind you about my book. If you want to learn the perfect time to eat a cheeseburger, ask your boss for a raise, become intimate, The Power of When is a great way to do it, or check out my quest. We talk a lot about chronotypes on the quest. There are over 220 studies in the book. And then if you want to find out more about me, you can check out my website, thesleepdoctor.com. Follow me on Facebook or on Instagram. Take the chrono quiz and absolutely positively check out the quest, guys. It's awesome. I love it. I recommend it to people all the time. So with that, I'm going to stop sharing my screen once again, and Greta is going to hop on board and tell me what to do next.
Yes. And I,
how'd I do, Greta?
Amazing. I am inspired. I'm inspired to actually continue with my gratitude. I'm just very sad that I don't have a bath here at home, but
Hot shower is okay. But okay, you really want to get under the heat and really let your body get hot at night, okay, because that heat then lowers. And you want to do the opposite actually in the morning. So one of the things that I do, and I'm glad you brought this up, Greta, is I actually start when I'm in the shower in the morning, I make it colder, colder, colder. So I do like a Wim Hof, like cold plunge, but in my shower in the morning, that wakes me up. I'll tell you what.
That's amazing. I also, I was so proud of myself that I was showering under cold shower here in Malaysia. And then last year in February, I went to visit Japan. And I realized that there's no cold water in Malaysia. It's warm. And then in Japan, my all cold showers went away. But actually, you mentioned that the mastery of sleep is an amazing quest. And I have to agree with that. I took it and I really love it. And I think it's full of amazing information. Now, very interesting thing that some people are asking, and I am curious all the time, because, you know, we are super achievers. We want more from life.
Oh, yeah.
So one of those interesting questions is, so how can I make myself sleep less? So I would like you not necessarily to answer exactly how, but what is your take on that, on actually minimizing the hours?
So I'll explain it because I believe in it. So here's what I've discovered. And this is over many years of research. And we've had, oh my gosh, now probably over 1.5 million people take the quiz. Here's what we've discovered. When people sleep only during their chronotypical bedtimes, the amount of sleep begins to shrink. So what happens is the quality of sleep improves so much just based on sleeping during your chronotypical bedtime that the sleep cycle begins to shrink. That's why I only sleep 6 hours and 15 minutes. I go to bed every single night at midnight, And my body naturally wakes me up at like 6:15 every day. I'm the sleep doctor, guys. And I only sleep 6 hours and 15 minutes because my sleep has become so high in quality because of the consistency of my schedule. So if you want to learn how to sleep less, sleep consistent.
So does it mean that this should come naturally, right? It's not that I'm forcing myself to sleep less and less, but no. I'm doing this according to my chronotype?
Yes, exactly.
Okay. Okay, yeah, that's good.
Yeah,
another thing, so there are some people who are not using any caffeine and they're very curious if there are any substitutes for your Napa latte. Yeah. Uh-huh. What would you do then?
Yeah, so people can use green tea if you like green tea instead. People can use anything that's a stimulant is really the goal here. Caffeine works the best. So if you don't drink coffee, you can have like a caffeine tablet. Or you can have something like that. But caffeine is really the thing that works the best because the molecule is so similar to the same molecule that helps with sleep. So you really want to have something that is caffeinated if you can.
Okay. 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 That's good. Mm-hmm. And then for banana tea, if let's say people don't eat bananas, are there any substitutes?
So the only thing that remember bananas is really for magnesium. And so the goal is to get as much magnesium as possible. So if you don't like bananas, the best thing that you could probably do at that point would be take a magnesium supplement. So maybe a pill of magnesium. You're looking for about 250 milligrams. I can tell you that there are powders that are really great that you can take before bed. So that it's like a teaspoon and you put it in some water and then you just drink the water before bed and you get all the magnesium. Again, that's in a supplement form. And here's the big thing to remember is magnesium, when it comes from a banana, is so much easier for your body to be able to absorb it. Now, there are also topicals. So there are like oils and lotions that can work quite well for magnesium. I've had a lot of people who have a tendency to like those. So I like that. It's okay. Like, you got to eat a banana every once in a while. It's just not going to kill you.
That's true.
Unless you're allergic.
Yeah, that would not be good.
That would not be
good. And talking about naps, I saw several questions. Let's say if the person had a bad night's sleep, right? Or could not sleep properly, or let's say now it's after midnight and my time and I would need to wake up for work tomorrow. So how long would I need to take naps if we're not talking only about Napa lattes, but maybe usual nap? So how long?
Great question. So here's the thing to remember, everybody, is you don't want to nap too long. I would say you never want to take a nap that's longer than 25 minutes. And I'll tell you why. So when you fall asleep, remember, you go from wake to stage one to stage two, then eventually you get into deep sleep. When you get into deep sleep, it takes roughly 45 minutes to get there. So if you stop sleep at 25 minutes, you wake up out of lighter sleep and it feels better. Have any of you ever taken a nap and felt worse, not better, after you've taken that nap? Like you're groggy and you're like, I can't, right? That's because you napped too long. 25 minutes, that's the longest the nap that you should have. Believe it or not, there's data to show that a 7 minutes is actually incredibly refreshing. They did it on the space station for the astronauts and they discovered that it was very, very refreshing. So you could even take a 7 minute nap if you wanted.
Okay, then a challenge or follow-up question is how to fall asleep for that? Because I was trying to nap before this session, before Mind Valley Nourished Online, and then my thoughts are all there. So how do I make sure I nap?
So here's the thing to remember. So people never get this, but I want to be very, very clear. An hour of just rest where your eyes are closed and you're just lying is worth about 20 minutes of sleep.
Okay.
Aha. Interesting. So even if you're just lying there with your eyes closed for 25 minutes, it still has some form of rejuvenation. You're still relaxing. You're taking yourself out. Again, what we're trying to do is give yourself a break. I saw a quick question. Is guava leaf extract okay instead of the tea? I've never used the extract, so I don't know. But it's the guava leaf is the key factor here. That's what the science is on. So I would argue that it's probably okay.
Okay, that's nice. So that means that when we have breaks in between of sessions, for those people who are especially on my side of the world, where Malaysia, Australia, Japan is, we can just rest a bit, recover, and then learn more, right?
Absolutely. And remember, everybody, that Napping, generally speaking, your body shouldn't require a nap. Like if you're getting good quality sleep at night, you probably shouldn't nap. And one thing to really remember is if you have insomnia, you should not nap. Like if you're a dolphin, no napping. You do not want to nap if you're a dolphin, because that lowers your sleep drive and makes it harder to fall asleep at night. And you already have a hard time sleeping. So if you have difficulty falling asleep or staying asleep, I would say you really don't want to nap if you possibly can. But if you want to take a 7-minute nap in between sessions at Mind Valley University, that's okay too, right? I mean, I don't mind, right? Like chill out, you know, because here's the other thing is there's lots of information going in, right? Like you're learning and that takes up a lot of glucose. So you could be a little tired after one of these sessions. Don't worry. Look, I'm the sleep doctor. I'm giving you permission, right? Take a little, you know, 7-minute nap in between sessions. You might be surprised. Meditation is one thing that I also want to talk to people about. Is sometimes people would rather do meditation than napping. I'm totally fine with that. There's even some data to suggest that meditation, deep, deep, deep forms of meditation, we're talking like TM, which is called transcendental meditation. This is a long study process that people go through. That actually replaces sleep for some people. I have one patient, he does transcendental meditation. And one of the things that he finds is he only sleeps 4 hours a night, but he does 2 hours a day of TM and it works out perfectly for him. So it's very, very interesting.
Okay. And then as you talked just now about those few hours per night, let's say there are people who work in shifts, right? At nighttime. Are there any specific tips for them or just they need to live it through?
So here's the thing. It's tough. Okay. Being a shift worker is hard to do. Our bodies were not meant for working at night unless you're a wolf, right? So if you take the chrono quiz and you discover that you're a wolf, you may actually do better working at night than an early morning job. Whereas if you're a lion, you might be great at getting to work by 7 a.m. because you're already up, right? So looking for work based on your chronotype can actually be very, very helpful. That's number one. Number two, if you're a shift worker, these are your best friend. These blue light blocking glasses. And I'll tell you why, because remember, you're going to work at 7 o'clock at night. Maybe you're leaving work at 7 o'clock in the morning. What you don't want is direct sunlight while you're driving home, right? That's where these glasses can come into play. So again, limit the amount of light that you have in the morning and stay consistent with your sleep. I know it doesn't feel good when you come home at 7 o'clock in the morning, right? You see your family for maybe a half an hour, you eat a little food, and then what happens? You kind of want to go to bed. Here's the problem with that. That's not what a normal schedule looks like, right? So when I come home from work, I don't eat and immediately go to bed, right? I sit down, I relax, I spend time with my family, then we have a meal, then I spend more time with my family, maybe I read a book, and then I finally go to bed, right? Mm-hmm. So you should be doing that same process, even if it's at 7 o'clock in the morning, right? But do it while wearing these blue light blocking glasses, and maintain your environment, because you really want your environment to be helpful at this point. So you want to have, you know, blackout shades. You want to have noise reduction, maybe a sound machine, earplugs. Things of this nature can be very, very helpful, because remember, the rest of the world is still going on while you're sleeping. And that can be very disruptive.
Yeah, that's true. Actually, there was one question that a lot of people voted for, and Lean asked that, about dreams and REM sleep. And the question is why some people do remember and some people don't remember, and what does it depend on? Is it REM sleep or brain functions, or what is it about?
Sure. So I get a lot of questions about dreams and dreaming, and I actually have an ebook. So if people want on my website, you can download an ebook to learn all about what is dreams and how does it work and things like that. We can put the link in the notes afterwards. That's easy.
Amazing.
But when we look at dreams and dreaming, there's a couple of different kind of functions with that, and trying to remember those dreams becomes very interesting. So I want to be very clear. I can teach you how to remember your dreams, but I cannot turn it off. So once you learn the skill, you will remember your dreams every day. I'm not convinced that everybody wants to do that, right? Mm-hmm. So just to be very, very clear here, if you want to remember your dreams, it's not that hard, and I'll explain to you exactly how to do it. So first of all, we have a tendency to remember our dreams when we wake up in the middle of REM sleep. So for example, if you have a tracker, like I have the Oura Ring tracker, or you're tracking your sleep, and you can figure out when your REM period is, if you set your alarm for that REM period and you wake up during it, you will absolutely positively remember your dreams. The easiest way to do that is to keep this. You remember I talked about having a notepad by the bed? When you wake up in the morning, write down everything that's in your head. Just dump it out of your head. Within 5 to 7 days, you'll start remembering your dreams. Again, be careful. Don't do it if you don't want to always remember your dreams. Okay, once you start getting able to do it, your brain just does it naturally.
Kind of training, right?
Exactly. I don't know about you guys, but there on occasion, I can have some dreams that I don't want to have, right? I mean, nightmares, you know, those kind of things. And so sometimes I don't want to remember those because that can have a big influence during the day. The only thing I've seen historically that can stop both nightmares and if you want to stop remembering your dreams is antidepressant medication like Zoloft and Prozac and things like that. That has a tendency to lower dream content, as well as marijuana or cannabis.
Okay, so actually, do I understand correctly that in order to remember our dreams, it's more like of a natural process, training yes. our brain and remembering, right. but the reverting is a bit harder one.
That's correct.
Okay. So what I noticed that with a lot of things, what we wanna improve or learn, there are actually a lot of simple ways, because yes. if you want to remember the dream, just start writing down. But what if right. there are people who don't even remember at all now? Like, what would be your mm-hmm. suggestion if they wanna start experiencing that?
So remember, track your sleep, and then mm-hmm. wake up during REM sleep, and then you will okay. naturally begin to do that. If you can't figure out that, just writing down anything that's in your head over about 7 to 10 days, it'll start to form. So it takes a little time.
Okay, that's good. So, and then for people who remember or don't remember, why? What is the difference? Why? Is it brain function?
So we don't really know the reasons why we remember it, other than the fact that we know that during REM sleep is when we move information from our short-term memory to our long-term memory. So in order to remember, we have to get through that REM process, right? And so if you want to remember the dreams, if you get in the middle of that process, the data is just very available. It's what we mm-hmm. think. We don't really know.
Okay. So people call you sleep doctor.
Yes.
And then if we think about people who experience other illnesses that might affect their sleep, would mm-hmm. sleep doctor help, or actually they would need to first go to other doctors and just then come back? How does it work with illnesses?
So this is a very interesting question. I'm really glad you brought this up, Greta. So you can go either direction. So many people, they think they have a sleep problem and it turns out to be a medical problem. And many people have a medical problem and it turns out to be a sleep problem, or even a mental health problem turns out to be a sleep issue. So let me give you an example. So if somebody on here turned to me and they said, you know, Dr. Breus, I need 9 hours of sleep or 10 hours of sleep, right? You might think, wow, they just sleep a lot. Not necessarily. Could be the quality of their sleep. What if they have sleep apnea and their body is making them sleep longer just to get the sleep because the sleep isn't so good? What if they have depression and they're escaping their feelings by going to sleep, right? And so we always have to, so what we're always looking for in sleep is people who are outside the norm. So if we know that the average individual gets somewhere between 7 and let's say 8.5 to 9 hours of sleep, if you get less than that, or if you get more than that, that's the time to start investigating. Remember, sleep can be a window into your health in many different ways. So let me give you another example. I had one patient, female patient, who had, a deficiency in magnesium. She had a deficiency in iron, and it turned out to cause restless legs syndrome, where she got this creepy crawly feeling on her legs every night before she went to bed, right? Now, when she went to the sleep doctor said, aha, I need to do a blood test first. Now I could give you medication for restless legs, but what if it's your iron? So we did the blood test and we discovered that it's iron, right? Mm-hmm. So that's an instance where the sleep doctor found a medical situation. The opposite holds true as well, right? Sometimes in the medical universe, people might see something, but again, it turns out to be sleep. So here's an instance where, for example, depression actually may look like sleep apnea, right? Mm-hmm. So some people who say, oh, I'm so tired all the time, I'm so fatigued all the time, I'm so depressed, maybe it's because they're not getting good quality sleep at night. Right. And so I think it goes in either direction. But here's one thing I will tell everybody who's listening. If you're not sleeping consistently and you don't feel as though your sleep is of good quality, it doesn't have to be perfect. Okay. Nobody's sleep is mine. I'm the sleep doctor. My sleep's not perfect. Right. It doesn't have to be perfect, but if you're noticing on a regular basis that you're not feeling so good, it's a sign. There's something else going on. Sleep is a window into both our mental and our physical health. So when we notice that something isn't going very well, we need to take a look.
Okay. That's very interesting. And I think this session is super beneficial. Guys, do you agree with me? We have more than 700 people here listening to these amazing tips. Thank you so much. And
of course,
let's have some more questions, okay?
Absolutely.
To see
throw it
how
out there,
we can serve the community.
Absolutely.
So some people are asking about snoozing and not waking up immediately.
Let's talk about it.
Is it still okay, or it actually affects our sleep?
No, I hate the snooze button. I hate it. Let me be clear. Snooze is bad, and I'll tell you why. So the average snooze button is 7 to 9 minutes long. So it's not enough time to get into deep sleep, right? Because remember, it takes almost 45 minutes to get there. So when you hit the snooze button, all you're doing is giving yourself light, crappy sleep. It's better for you to just wait until the last possible moment and get up. And the best is to not use an alarm clock at all, but to wake up naturally at your chronotypical wake-up time. Remember, if you go to bed at the right time for your chronotype, you will naturally wake up at the right time. I promise. But yeah, alarm clocks suck. That's just the bottom line.
Okay. Well, then if we could be like practical, let's imagine. Mm-hmm. Actually, I had this problem for a while that I would be snoozing all the time. And I know people in my community, they always have 5 alarm clocks, which is crazy.
It's terrible.
Then what would be, let's say, first step they can take in order to make their life easier?
To do what? To make their life easier?
To stop snoozing.
Oh, to stop snoozing. So number one is, if you sleep with somebody sleeping next to you, tell your bed partner that you don't want to hit the snooze button, because they will hit you in the shoulder and wake you up. So that's number one. Number two, take the alarm clock, if you need an alarm clock, and put it across the room. Force your body to get up out of bed, walk across the room to turn that thing off, okay? That's number two. Number three, if you have an animal that you live with, like a dog, right? Set a time every single day to take that dog for a walk in the morning, like when you wake up. That dog will be your permanent alarm clock, I promise you, because that's what my dog does. Is at 6:15, he starts licking my face, and we're up and going. How about six cats at 5 a.m.? That's funny. I like that one. We have a cat as well. I'm a cat and a dog fan, all of which are great. Hey, let's talk about pets in the bed, because that's certainly something that happens a lot. I have two pets in my bed. So it's me, it's my French bulldog, it's my cat, and it's my wife. Okay. All of us in the bed together. It's like Lion Country Safari, right? It's crazy. All right. Here's the thing. When you look at animals, if they're not disruptive, it's all good, right? If you've got I have a French bulldog, okay, and he snores, right? So what do? I point his head away from me. So I send the snore out into the rest of the room, and it doesn't bother me, right? So again, you've just got to decide what you need and what makes sense with the animal. Some animals I've trained to sleep in different rooms. Some animals would like to have a little bed that sits on the side of your bed. There's lots of ways to do this, I promise you.
Mm-hmm. And if we talk about animals, and when I think about Dr. Michael Breus, I remember
you're
going to
talk about kids, right?
Ah, no, chronotypes.
Oh, I thought you were going to talk about kids in the bed.
We can talk about kids in the bed then.
Okay, cool.
What about that?
Yeah, well, and also for folks out there within the Mind Valley universe, you should definitely check out Tiny Humans, because that's a program that you guys are going to be doing soon, and it's got a lot of great stuff about kids. But when we talk about kids in the bed, one of the things that you really want to be thinking about here is, remember, don't do anything once that you don't want to do for 3 years, okay? 3 years. I'm not joking, right? Oh, little humans. Yeah, not little humans, not tiny humans. I'm sorry.
Tiny humans.
Tiny. Well, they are tiny humans, right? Well, they're little, they're tiny. What do you want to call them? So little humans. Thank you, guys. So one of the things you want to remember is, when you put a baby in your bed, there's a lot of different things that can happen, right? So number one, you need to be careful, right? Because you can roll over and hurt the child. So number one rule is, if you have a child in your bed, nobody drinks alcohol, period. Nobody has alcohol at all that night. Because here's what happens is you go into such a deep sleep that you roll over and you hurt the child. That in almost every incidence where we have a child that gets hurt in a family bed, it's because there's alcohol somewhere around. So no drinking whatsoever. Number two, I had a basket for my son. So we had, it's called a Moses basket. So it's a little, you know, it's a little basket. And we set it right between the two of us and my wife could scoop him out, breastfeed, and then put him back in. And then we moved the basket to the side of the bed. And then we moved it to the other side of the room. And then we moved it into his room. And so it's a process of slowly getting your child out of the bedroom, if they're in the bedroom to begin with. Many children go to sleep just fine. And there are no issues with that at all. So I don't want people to worry about that.
Yeah. So natural process to move them out to sleep alone. But can we move our chronotypes? Like, because some people are asking, like, do they change naturally over time?
So we do. And so when we're children, we actually go through all of the chronotypes. So when you're an itty bitty baby, you're a lion, right? Because think about babies. They go to bed early and they wake up really early, right? And then when you're a toddler and in middle school, you're a bear. You kind of go to bed when the sun goes down. You kind of wake up when the sun comes up. And then you're a teenager, right? And then you become a wolf, right? So I have two teenagers. It's terrible. Let me just be clear. It's awful. Okay. I have an 18-year-old and a 16-year-old and they're a pain in the butt. I love my children more than anything in the universe, but they are crazy, right? Especially when it comes to sleep. Because what do they want to do? They want to sleep. They want to go to bed late and they want to sleep late. They are all wolves, right? Then around age 18, 19, 20, your chronotype has a tendency to set and your body will pick one. It's all based on genetics, by the way. So if you do 23andMe or Ancestry.com, we can tell you exactly what your chronotype is pretty easily, by the way. Then you stay there until you hit about 50, 55. So I'm 52. And what I've started to see is all of a sudden, I'm getting tired a little bit earlier, right? It's not midnight for me anymore. Now it's more closer to 11:45. So my entire universe is going back a little. And so I'm moving away from being a wolf, and I'm probably going to start becoming a late bear is what I like to call it. So that's the other thing to remember is within the chronotypes, we've had almost 1.5 million people take the quiz now. We've discovered that there are early bears and there are late bears, right? So there are people who still fit in the bear schedule, but they like to actually go to bed a little bit later or like to go to bed a little bit earlier. That's okay. There are hybrids out there. And I actually wrote an entire article on hybrids that we can get to people as well.
That is good. That's good. And again, what is your chronotype? I think I'm
my chronotype is a wolf. I'm a late person. I never go to bed before midnight ever. Although lately, let's say in the last 6 months, I'm definitely getting sleepier around 11:45. And I, like I said, I'm 52. So my guess is that I probably should like test my melatonin. And so I'll take a look because this is the one time that I think melatonin as a supplement makes a lot of sense is for many people, because the melatonin production becomes low in the body, you can supplement with melatonin. So you would want to take somewhere between 0.5 and 1.5 milligrams. And remember, melatonin is easy to come by in the United States, but in many places in Europe, it's by prescription only. So you probably have to talk with your doctor.
Okay, that's good. What I see that we got today, a lot of practical tips. And not only that, I saw a lot of people in the chat resonating with your beautiful words about your teenagers. That's beautiful. You know, they say that for people, it's so important to belong and feel that they're not alone. So definitely, I believe that we understood that we're not alone. Life happens. And if our sleep is not perfect, even the sleep doctor is sometimes like
of course.
Something not perfectly, right?
Of course. I'm a human. I'm not, exactly. I'm not a tiny human or a little human. I'm a big human.
Yeah. I would like to ask you to, let's say, wrap up this and maybe there's like a summary or a magical tip or something that you would like to leave us with today.
Absolutely. So here's what I want to do because I gave everybody a lot of information today is I'm going to break down and I'm going to just do the top five tips of what you should do to help with your sleep right now. Actually, I'm going to give six.
Perfect.
So step number one. Stick to one sleep schedule, right? So each numbered step is going to have that number inside the step. Step number one, one wake up time. Step number two, stop caffeine by 2 p.m. Okay. Step number three is to stop alcohol 3 hours before bed, right? Step number four is to exercise daily, but to stop exercise 4 hours before bed. And step number five is to give the sun a high five every morning and get 15 minutes of sunlight every morning. If you do those five things, you are going to be in good shape. But there's a sixth step. So after you do those five things, if you still have issues or you want to learn more, go check out my quest. Check out my sleep quest. I promise you guys, we spent a tremendous amount of time and energy on this thing. It's super interesting. You're going to learn things that I don't even have the time now to explain to you all the different things that you can learn from this quest. But everybody that seems to be going through the quest is coming out the other side and really feels like they have a great understanding of sleep. They feel like they know what to do about their sleep, and they're really progressing in a very positive way. So if I had one super big tip, go check out the quest. I think you'll dig it.